Good morning, St. Michael's.
Can everybody hear me all right? Yes. There we go. Okay. Hi. Good morning. It's so good to see so many of you here this morning, especially on such a wet and rainy day. Today is a special day in our calendar year. Today we are doing an instructed Eucharist, which I suspect that many of you know about by now. An instructed Eucharist is a special service where periodically we will pause and explain a little bit of the why behind our service and our liturgy, why we stand the way that we do, why we pray the way that we do, and sometimes why we wear the things that we do. So before the service ever begins, of course, the altar guild sets up the altar. We have beautiful flowers and candles to reflect the beauty of God in the world. And then the ministers and then those who are serving up at the altar spend some time getting vested. So I'm going to say a few minutes about the vestments that we wear in our service. The first vestment that anybody serving at the altar always wears is this long white garment that's called an alb, A-L-B. An alb is an ancient garment that was worn pretty much everywhere, particularly in Rome. It was kind of like your basic garment. So when you read, particularly in the Gospel of John, when we hear about Jesus wearing a single white tunic, this is kind of similar to what he would have been wearing. We wear it because the white of the color symbolizes our baptism, the cleanse, the purity that we receive in the sacrament of baptism, how that is the basic form of our identity as Christians. And of course, microphones so that people can hear what you're saying is always good to have.
After the alb, we have what looks like a length of rope.
This is called a cincture with a C. A cincture is essentially more of a functional garment. It's something that you wrap around your waist with a particular knot in order to make sure that your alb doesn't go back and forth, doesn't kind of become distracting to anybody else. So it acts more as a belt than anything else.
After the cincture, we of course have the stole that is worn by all clergy.
The stole is a sign and a symbol of the role and of the call of clergy. Clergy always wear the stole whenever they're performing any kind of sacrament, be it a Eucharist, baptism, wedding, anything. It's a sign that we have been empowered by the church to perform sacraments on behalf of the church. In the Episcopal Church, we pretty much always wear our stole straight down like this. Often in Orthodox churches, they'll wear it crossed across their chest. And in deacons, who have a different role within the church, will wear their stoles from their left shoulder to their right hip, to symbolize that they are working in a different order and called to a different form of service. Now that the ministers for the service are vested and prepared, we prepare and get ready for our service. I'm going to pass it over to Steve to say a few words about our opening hymns.
The first act of our worship is the gathering of the people at prayer. In fact, the word church means the gathering, as we gather in a special way through music and the procession. The procession also reminds us that the people of God, through time and history, are moving toward God's kingdom, following the cross of Christ and bringing the light of the gospel into all the world. We bring to our worship our whole being. We pray not just with words, but with our every sense. We pray silently and we pray out loud as we pray through music. We pray with our bodies through our stances of sitting, standing, and kneeling. We pray by sight through the visual symbols that surround us. And we pray even with our sense of taste and smell through the bread and wine we will soon share. So we begin by standing as a sign of respect. And standing is the best way to sing. And so let us gather as we sing.
Exalted, the King is exalted on high. Oh, praise Him.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed is his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. In Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, because without you we are not able to please you, mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
The Liturgy of the Word. There are two halves to the Eucharist which we should keep in mind as we experience our worship together. The first is the Liturgy of the Word, sometimes called the Anticommunion, anti meaning before. The Liturgy of the Word includes several parts. One, the opening prayers, which come from the Book of Common Prayer. Two, lessons from the First and Second Testaments that have been appointed for the day. Three, the sermon. Four, the church's statement of faith called the Nicene Creed. And five, the intercessions or the prayers of the people.
Our first reading today is from the book of Jeremiah. At that time it will be said to this people and to Jerusalem, a hot wind comes from me out of the bare heights in the desert toward my poor people, not to winnow or cleanse, a wind too strong for that. Now it is I who speak in judgment against them. For my people are foolish, they do not know me. They are stupid children, they have no understanding. They are skilled in doing evil, but do not know how to do good. I looked on the earth, and lo, it was waste and void, into the heavens, and they had no light. I looked on the mountains, and lo, they were quaking, and all the hills moved to and fro. I looked, and lo, there was no one at all, and all the birds of the air had fled. I looked, and lo, the fruitful land was a desert, and all its cities were laid in ruins before the Lord, before his fierce anger. For thus says the Lord, the whole land shall be a desolation, yet I will not make a full end. Because of this, the earth shall mourn, and the heavens above grow black. For I have spoken, I have purposed. I have not relented, nor will I turn back. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Psalm and Simplified Anglican Chant. William Bradley Roberts once said, "They who sing pray twice." The Book of Psalms, sometimes called the Psalter, were composed throughout Israel's history and reflect a vast range of subjects and emotions. The word psalm is derived from a Greek term meaning song and follows the Hebrew for hymns or songs of praise. So the Psalms are frequently sung or chanted. In Jewish synagogues, there is a cantor who leads the Psalms, but even when these prayers are spoken, they have a musical cadence. In our Anglican tradition, there is a wide selection of psalmody to choose from. There are monastic chants or Anglican chants where the notes change throughout the phrase, and they may have a modern or contemporary settings. Some psalms found in the 1982 hymn book are paraphrases of psalms.
Psalm today is Psalm 14. We will read whole verse by whole verse responsibly, and the last verse all together. The fool has said in his heart, "There is no God. All are corrupt and commit abominable acts. There is none who does any good."
The Lord looks down from heaven upon us all to see if there is any who is wise, and if there is one who seeks after God.
Everyone has proved faithless. All alike have turned bad. There is none who does good. No, not one. See how they tremble with fear, because God is in the company of the righteous.
Their aim is to confound the plans of the afflicted, but the Lord is their refuge. Oh, that Israel's deliverance would come as of Zion, when the Lord restores the fortunes of his people. Jacob will rejoice, and Israel will be glad.
The second reading today is a reading from the first letter of Paul to Timothy. I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief. And the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason, I receive mercy, so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example of those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The final reading at a Eucharistic service always comes from one of the four Gospels. Christians have long given special importance to the Gospels because there is what we hear directly, the words and actions of Jesus. We express this importance by having an ordained minister do this reading and by standing when we listen to it. If there is a deacon present, it is always the deacon's prerogative to do the Gospel reading. On most Sundays, there is a gospel procession into the center of the congregation, signifying that the gospel is at the center of our life as a faith community. It is appropriate for us to stand and turn, facing the gospel book and reader as a sign of respect. Our gospel procession echoes the Jewish practice of carrying the Torah, the scrolls containing the law, into the congregation. The gospel procession does one more thing. It reminds us that we are to carry the good news of Jesus Christ into all the world. Making the sign of the cross with your thumb and forehead, mouth and chest this time is how we ask God's blessing to be in our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. This way of making the sign of the cross is one of the earliest known symbols of the church and goes back to the second century.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near, listening to Jesus. The Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. When he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I found my sheep that was lost." Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Be seated. Good morning again.
Good morning.
Normally in the service at this point, we would have our sermon, which seeks to open up the gospel reading, or any one of the readings, or psalms, or prayers, in order to create context for the community and help people to connect the eternal word of God with people's everyday life experience. Now, since today is a special day with the Instructed Eucharist, we're going to skip over that for now, and we'll go right into Nicene Creed. So I'll invite Julie to say a few things about the Creed before we begin.
Now we will recite together the Nicene Creed, which was written in the 4th century to state the Church Trinitarian belief of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The last part of the creed addresses the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God at work in the world and in the church even now. The church is one under Christ, holy because the Spirit guides it, Catholic because it proclaims the whole faith to all people, and apostolic because it continues the teaching, fellowship, and mission of the apostles. The creed was written as an affirmation of the faith for bishops, but has evolved into a central part of our worship. The creed expresses the faith of the whole church in all times and places. Although the meaning of some of the phrases may not be clear, try thinking of the creed as a prayer that you share with everyone today who is reciting this creed in their church, and think of it as a prayer you share with everyone who has gone before us, who has recited this, and everyone who will come after us and pray these same words. The creed is a part of our communion with all Christians in all times and places. Some make the sign of the cross at the end of the creed to remind us that our baptism, we were signed with the sign of the cross and made Christ's own forever. Such acts of reverence are how we show outwardly what we believe inwardly.
Together, let us stand and proclaim the words of our faith as found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ,
the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. In confidence, we offer our prayers to the Lord, saying, Lord, hear our prayer. That the church may shine with the glory of the face of Christ, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. Bless the leaders of our land, that we may be a people at peace among ourselves and a blessing to other nations of the earth. Pray especially for Joe Biden, our president, Eric Holcomb, our governor, Chris Jensen, our mayor, for this city of Noblesville. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For those serving in the military, Nahum Cook, Samantha Embers, Ben Garrett, Caleb Garrett, Tommy Harris, Brayton Harrison, Ken Morrison. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. That each Sabbath brings us that all of us gathered here may have recreation and refreshment this Sunday and every Sunday. And for those celebrating birthdays this week, Vincent Dingman, Julie Gooden, Joey Lewis, Bill Linden, Aiden Moore, Sarah Wood, and for all those celebrating anniversaries, Lisa and Dave Sola. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. That each Sabbath brings us closer to the health and wholesomeness of God's reign. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. That all the sick may be healed, we pray for those who have asked for our prayers, especially Grant Cook, Rick Manning, Pat Johnson, Lydia Wente, Paige Sexton, Ken Bush, and Nancy Allen. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for St. John's in Speedway, Becky Douglas, Senior Warden. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the souls of those who have passed from this world into the glory of God, that light perpetual may shine upon them, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
The confession and the absolution. Now we ask God's forgiveness for the wrongs we have done collectively as the people of God. Confession is an important part of prayer, whether we do it privately or in church with others. As the confession is announced, we recite together the words of the confession. Please notice that when we say these words out loud, we are confessing our sins as a gathering of God's people and not as individuals. It is another way we pray together as the people of God. The confession reminds us that not all our sins are individual. We live and participate in a systems and cultures that do not respect the dignity of every human being. After we have made our confession, the priest says the words of absolution or forgiveness, assuring us that God has forgiven all of us.
Together, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
God of all mercy, we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our lives. We have denied your goodness in each other, in ourselves, and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that has enslaved us, the evil we have done, and the evil done on our behalf. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only your will. Amen.
Mighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
So we're now ready for the best part, the peace. The first part of the service is now completed. We greet one another joyfully in the spirit of friendship and reconciliation and in the love of God, exchanging peace of God with one another. It is a way for us to heal from our grudges and wounds and be reconciled to our neighbor before coming to the table of communion. The passing of the peace is a very ancient way for people to greet one another. Jesus taught us that we should love one another as sisters and brothers. The Apostle Paul taught that we should forgive one another as God forgives us before we come to the table to share in the bread of communion. It is also a sacramental way in which God's peace is truly and actually passed to each other.
May the peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning, St. Michael's. You may be seated for just a moment for a few announcements before we continue on with our service. Just a couple of very brief reminders today. That's right. just a reminder that we are continuing our book study of Tinashe Coates' book, Between the World and Me. That's taking place Sunday mornings downstairs at 9 o'clock. I highly encourage you to read the book if you haven't before. It is a very fascinating read, and it's sparking a lot of really good conversation in our group. So that's Sundays at 9 o'clock downstairs. This Wednesday at 7. This Wednesday at 7, we have our vestry meeting here at church at 7. All are welcome to join. If you would like, you're welcome to log in via Zoom. Please keep in mind that all vestry meetings are open, and the vestry minutes and financials are posted in the narthex on the bulletin board. So if you're curious about what decisions we're making, what's going on, I encourage you to take a look there. The only other announcement that I have is just a reminder that next week, 1 week from today, after the 10 o'clock service, we'll have our St. Michael's breakfast brunch. Sure. Hope that you're able to join us next week. If you haven't signed up, there's a sign-up sheet in the narthex. Please just put your name down and how many people are attending, just so we can keep track and have an idea of how many people to prepare for. A big thank you to Rita for helping to spearhead it and put it all together. So thank you. Julie?
Yes, the Women's Monthly Gathering has had a change of date. We're going to meet on the 26th at Sue Duchess instead of the 19th. Anything else?
Before we continue on with our offertory sentence and the second half of our service with the liturgy of the table, I would like Jan Ford to say a few words.
Holy Communion. We now begin the second part of the Eucharist. There are four parts to this portion of the service. The first is the offering of money and the bread and wine we will use at communion. The second part is the prayer of thanksgiving and the consecration of the bread and the wine. The third is the breaking of the bread, and the fourth is the receiving of communion. In the early days of the church, worshipers brought their own bread and wine to the service. The deacons chose what was needed for the consecration, and the rest was set aside for the poor. Today, we normally have lay people who bring the bread and wine to the altar. The bread and the wine, which are called oblations, along with the money collected for the work of the church, are the offerings that will be presented to God, consecrated, and received by God's people with thanksgiving. This is the heart and the culmination of our worship. The great thanksgiving begins with the offertory sentence, which reminds us that all our possessions are really God's gifts. The reason we usually take an offering of money in this part of the service rather than at some other juncture is because the fruit of our labor is a part of our great thanksgiving. And so we begin with an offertory sentence.
And please keep in mind that here at St. Michael's, Holy Communion is for anybody who desires to have a closer relationship with God. So please know that you're welcome to receive. To receive, you simply come forward, you may kneel or stand. Place one hand in front of the other to receive the bread. We have gluten-free wafers available upon request. And then you may either dip the bread in the pottery chalice, or you may sip directly from the silver chalice. If for whatever reason you choose not to receive communion, you're still invited to come forward. Simply cross your arms in front of your chest to receive a blessing. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
The congregation may join us in singing this old favorite hymn.
Down by the riverside, down by the riverside, down by the riverside, gonna lay down my sword. Setting the table. A deacon or priest sets the table by laying first a corporal, a white linen cloth, upon which are placed a chalice, a cup for the wine, and a paten, a plate for the bread. The purpose of the corporal is to hold any crumbs that may come from the bread. Next, wine is poured into the chalice, and a little water is added. Adding a little water to the wine was a sign of hospitality in the Middle East in the time of Jesus. Many people who understand the adding of water to signify the blood and water that came out of Jesus' side when stabbed by the spear, or to represent the two natures, divine and human, coexisting in Jesus the Christ. We typically use vessels made from precious metals as a way of honoring the importance of communion. We use linen cloths on the altar or holy table in ways which are very similar to the way in which you might use linen or other special napkins and tablecloths at a fancy dinner party. In fact, both scripture and Christian tradition often compare a communion to a great heavenly banquet or a feast of all the saints. Before the priest begins speaking the Eucharistic prayer, it is the custom in many churches an acolyte pours a little water over the priest's fingers. The receptacle for this purpose is called a lavabo. This reminds us that we should all come to God's altar with clean hands and pure hearts. It has long been the custom for the head of the Jewish household to wash his or her hands in a similar way before the prayers of the Passover meal. It is very likely Jesus did this at the Last Supper. The priest now says the great thanksgiving. The prayers we use follow an ancient format written by Hilopoeus in the second century. They are based on the accounts of the Last Supper, primarily found in the Gospel of Luke and the letters of Paul. We are doing two basic things in the Eucharistic prayer. We are remembering the ancient story and sharing in the blessing through the blessing of bread and wine. The prayer reminds the story of the people of God and makes it our own story. And we ask God's blessing on us through the blessing of the bread and wine in our communion. These prayers invite us into four actions. By thanking, we remember God's love for us and how we turned away from God, and that God came to us as Jesus Christ to share our human nature so that we might be brought back to God. Remembrance, here is the Greek anonymous, which means that the act in which we are participating is actually made present, brought into here and now with us. We are not merely recalling or pretending to celebrate the Lord's Supper with Christ. We are celebrating with him in the here and now. The priest touches the bread and the chalice just as Christ did at the Last Supper, and we receive just as the disciples did that night. Then by remembering, by invoking, we pray.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy, but chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death. By his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels, and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we fail to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us, and so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us, prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. And the night before he died for us, our Savior, Jesus Christ, took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance." Supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. That we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hallelujah. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
Behold the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Eat on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving.
The communion of the people. The gifts we gave at offertory, the bread and the wine, are now returned to us. Because God has accepted these gifts, they are changed. They are for us the body and blood of Christ. They become for us love, grace, and strength. You may have been receiving communion your whole life, or this is new to you. So let me remind you again how to receive the bread and the wine of communion. For the bread, cup your hands and hold them up so that the priest can easily place the bread in the palm of your hand. You may then consume the bread or dip it in the wine and then place it in your mouth. If you wish to receive the chalice, please guide it to your lips by holding the bottom of the cup and not the top. If you do not wish to receive the wine, you can cross your arms over your chest and the priest will give you a blessing. After you have received the bread and the wine, it is appropriate to say,
thank you.
The post-communion prayer. After everyone has received communion, the bread and wine are moved to the side, and the altar guild will reverently clean the vessels. Some of the consecrated bread and wine may be reserved for the sick or those who are unable to come to church. This reserved sacrament is kept in the ombre or tabernacle, a cabinet located just behind the altar. We take consecrated bread to the sick and shut-in members of our congregation so that they may share with us in Holy Communion. Since they cannot come to church, we take church to them. So please let us know when circumstances are such that you would like us to bring communion to you. It's almost time for us to go, but we should not leave before we say together the prayer of thanksgiving. After this, the priest will give us God's blessing before we are dismissed back into the world, having been fed with God's abundant love.
Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us in your image and nourishing us with spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth a people forgiven, healed, renewed, that we may proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. May the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. To love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.